about 75. This is simply delightful. Winds have switched from the northwest now with passage of that front. So 11 miles per hour in Gibson, 10 in Louisville. Generally speaking, light around 5 to 10 miles per hour. Tonight, it will be a pretty one and fairly mild, too. We can hang on to these mild temperatures into the 60s, but we'll increase the clouds as we get into later on for tonight. Can you smell the flowers? They smell fabulous. Spring temperatures are going to take a bit of a break tomorrow, and then we're going to put them right back to work over the weekend. High 70s for Saturday, 80s for Sunday. It's the best emoji I can find for it. So we'll talk about that, but we'll talk about tomorrow's chance of showers, too. All of that in just a few minutes. Jenny Brand.
Tim, thanks. Monday afternoon's fires at several homes on Telfair Street in Augusta now being investigated as arson. A newly released sheriff's office incident report describes a suspect who said he was going to burn the houses. The suspect described as a man in his 50s. All we know is that he had on a light denim jacket. Not a whole lot about him at this point. We'll let you know if we get more details. We can tell you that the last time anybody saw this person, it was at the Chevron on East Boundary. If you know anything about who he is, call the Richmond County Sheriff's Office.
Crews are back on the scene today trying to remove train cars that derailed last night in Augusta. It happened near Old Savannah Road shortly after 6 p.m. Several cars from a Norfolk Southern train derailed along with about 15 CSX cars. Augusta Fire believes the conductor of the Norfolk Southern train had a medical emergency. He was taken to the hospital with non-life-threatening injuries. A spokesman for Norfolk Southern says neither train was carrying potentially dangerous material.
The Richmond County Sheriff's Office investigating a murder case. Here's what we know so far. Tyone Lambert is charged with murder in the death of Joe Nunley Jr. Lambert accused of hitting Nunley with a shovel. Investigators say the two men were hanging out last night with several other people on Ramsey Street when it happened, and deputies found the unresponsive victim lying in the street. Nunley died just after midnight.
A little girl from Evans is making incredible progress after she was accidentally shot nearly a year ago. News Channel 6's Mary Calkins met up with the family today to find out more.
10 months ago, doctors said that she would be paralyzed from the neck down, and today, her mother says she's a miracle.
Joelle Curry was shot in the chest at a home in Evans last year when three children were left unattended and a gun went off while one of them was playing with it.
Life with her right now is a little bit different than what I expected because I never expected this traumatic event to happen.
Despite doctors' fears, Joelle has worked to become independent. The night Joelle was shot, her mother was told she wouldn't survive the night. But right now, she pushes her own wheelchair and she's learning to walk again using a walker.
Well, at one point she wasn't able to move her legs at all, but now she can move her legs. She'll be a gladiator out here if she was on the ground by herself.
Despite Joelle's incredible progress, her mother, Stephanie Thomas, still faces four charges of cruelty to children.
As it stands today, Thompson's case is pending review at the district attorney's office. She has not been indicted, but is still an active case. Part of the delay, or maybe primarily, has been COVID.
Andre Green, who police say owns the gun used to shoot the toddler, was also charged in this case. But right now, Thomas says she's focused on her daughter.
We're going to run with it, and we're going to do what we have to do in order to make her happy and prosper in life.
Joelle has had 13 surgeries, and she's now attending elementary school, where she's one of the youngest students.
She's a queen now, and everywhere she goes, she's a spotlight and a star.
In Appling, Mary Calkins, WJBF News Channel 6.
All the best as sweet Joelle continues her recovery. Winnebago County's top law enforcer.
In the foreseeable future, but right now we don't have a date in mind. At some point last year, September, October, we had three terms of court. We had one jury trial in each of those terms of court. That don't move the needle very much.
Now, the pandemic sure isn't helping things here. Weeks also talked about what they can do if they can get more money to potentially help whittle down this caseload even more. And he tells us how things he learned on the basketball court are helping him in the judicial court. It's a great interview with the new solicitor, and you'll want to watch it on WJBF.com.
More than 1,500 rape kits are waiting to be tested in Georgia, and more delivered every day. Lawmakers are hoping to set up a system so kids can be tracked from the moment they're taken into the hospital to when they leave the GBI lab. News Channel 6's Chloe Salcimeda explains.
It could take months to test a rape kit, and this could be a very difficult time for survivors of rape and sexual assault. A new bill in Georgia looks to set up a website to track the location and status of the kits from start to finish. Survivors of sexual assault often wait months for answers. Those answers may be waiting on the shelves of the GBI Crime Lab, where hundreds of rape kits are sitting. But a new bill looks to bring them some relief. It would require the state to create an online tracking system that survivors could monitor.
They will have an ability to log in to a website just like we do in other contexts to see where is the kit now, what has happened to the kit, has it been tested? If it has been tested, does that match to any potential suspects?
If approved, the site could be up and running in 2021, hopefully giving survivors the answers they've been waiting for. Chloe Salcimeda, WJBF, News Channel 6.
When it comes to changing voting laws,